Today we are going to talk about Scottsdale Airport and the nuances and differences that you need to know if you are planning to fly to or from Scottsdale. I decided to make this video because I noticed that each airport has its own set of rules, and some of them are not documented. Just as a reminder, I am not a CFI, and I'm just giving you my personal experience and the information I have gathered flying from and to Scottsdale. Let's go over the agenda. First, we'll go over the basic airport information and operation. Next, we'll talk about the instructions you may get from Scottsdale and some of the things which are different. Then we'll go over reporting point, flying to the airport, and flying the pattern. We will end with some things to remember as you fly to or from Scottsdale. First, I want to thank Scottsdale Airport employee. I did all my training at Scottsdale Airport and everybody has been nice and helpful. The tower always tried to help you and accommodate your request for short approach and touch and go. Next, I will advise anybody who is flying from Scottsdale Airport to call for a tour of the tower. It was a great experience for me. At this time, you will have to wait until COVID is under control. They don't allow anybody to visit the tower. Let's go over what we know about the airport. Scottsdale is a Class Delta airport. I'm going to highlight the airspace for you. It goes from the ground all the way to 3,999. As you can see, the airspace is under Phoenix Bravo airspace. This is very important when you are planning your cross country. Let's take a look at the runway. You have runway 3 and runway 21. I did 90% of my landing on the runway 21. Runway 3 is mostly used in the morning and at night. The wind seems to favor runway 21 most of the time. Let's compare the total number of operations that the different airports in the valley had for the year 2020. As you can see, the report is from January 2020 to December 2020. Then we can see that in first place, we have Deer Valley with 402,000 operation. Deer Valley has two runways, which means that on average is 201,000 operation per runway. Phoenix is next with 310,000. Falcon, 307,000. Mesa Gateway, 259,000. Chandler, 214,000. And then we found Scottsdale with 195,000. Now, Scottsdale has only one runway. Then if we compare the average number of operations per runway, Scottsdale will be number two after Deer Valley. Now you can see that Scottsdale has a lot of operation and a lot of traffic. Here is a picture I took while I was holding short of Alpha 15. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4 planes on the taxi lane, plus 2 planes were waiting at Alpha 16. That's a total of 7 planes waiting to take off. This shows you how busy the airport is. And you can see we have 2 jets on the taxi lane. Which brings me to my next point. Scottsdale is a major jet hub. A lot of jets are flying in and out of Scottsdale. And that has a major impact on how you fly in and out of Scottsdale yourself. Let's take a look at some examples of multi-engine and jet landing at Scottsdale on Fly Radar 24. We are looking for the path the plane used, the speed and the altitude at a specific point. In our first example, the plane is coming from San Diego, and we are looking at the altitude and speed around Pinnacle Peak. The altitude is around 3,700 feet and the ground speed is around 166. Now, we know that those information are not exact, but that just gives us an idea. Now, let's take a look at another fly. This is the same plane coming from Las Vegas, and you can see it's taking a similar path. It's around the same altitude and a little bit faster in this case. Next fly, same things around Pinnacle Peak and going after directly to the runway. It's around 4,000 feet and the airspeed is around the same 188 in this case. Our last case for runway 21, it's a jet coming from San Diego. The altitude is 4,000, the speed is 190 knots. It's a little bit more on the west of Pinnacle Peak, but it's around the same area. Now we are going to take a look at some example for runway 3. Here is a jet at 4,800, ground speed 189, and around Pinnacle Peak again we are looking. In this case the jet is higher because it has to land on runway 3, which is further away. In the next example, similar situation around Pinnacle Peak, 5,300, speed is 231. And I just wanted to show you an example of a jet that took a wider path and may not impact how you are flying out of the airport. Now you can see the average speed is over 150 knots around Pinnacle Peak, and the altitude is between 3,000 to 6,000 feet. This will have a major impact on how you are flying out of Scottsdale. Now let's take a look at the map and see, you know, how those fly impact your departure from Scottsdale. What did we learn from looking at Flight Radar 24? Most of the planes that we look at fly over Pinnacle Peak. And they fly at between 3,500 to 6,000 feet. This is the area that you need to be really careful. Generally, when I fly out of Scottsdale, I'm going to try to fly toward Black Mountain or toward Carefree Airport. Like this, I stay out of the way of the jet, but still need to be really careful. Another reason to be careful in this area is on this side, you have the Northeast practice area and planes are coming to Scottsdale to land at Scottsdale, or planes are going to Deer Valley. Then you need to be careful. It's more like a cross street of multiple airplanes trying to go in different locations. Talking to people from out of state, I realized that most of the airports around the Phoenix area handle a high volume of traffic. And out of state pilots may get surprised and may not be familiar with some of the instructions given by the tower. I decided to compile two lists of instructions. The first one for the instruction which you will most likely get, and the second for more atypical instruction. Let's go over the first list.
Sierra 54, thank you. Help continue down. Okay, base traffic will be holding in position.
This is a very easy instruction. The tower will let you know when you can turn base.
Sierra 54, extend up. Call Carson.
This is a similar situation when the tower will let you know when you can turn crosswind.
Sierra 95, extend up 1 mile and continue with right to close traffic.
This is a more tricky situation. How do you know that you extended upwind 1 mile? You have two options. Option number one, you can use a timer, then looking at your ground speed. If your ground speed is between 60 to 90 knots, you can estimate that it will take you between 45 to 60 seconds per mile. Number two, you can just use your GPS system and put Scottsdale as your destination.
Meter 54, make a left 360.
The tower may ask you to do a right or a left 360 at standard rate turn.
And 852, actually just continue making left 360 still advise. I won't be able to squeeze you in.
I included this call to show you how busy the airport is. On this fly, I had to do 5 to 6 360 before I could land.
Aviator 47, you're following Cessna on the up, and they were extending for 1 mile, and then they're going to turn cross, and just follow them.
If you are going to fly at Scottsdale, it's very important that you are able to spot traffic. The tower may not call your base or may not call the crosswind. They may just ask you to follow the traffic.
Aviator 54, runway 21, line up away.
In this case, you are holding short of the runway and the tower is letting you know that you can get on the runway, but you are not yet clear for takeoff. You will have to wait. Another thing that is very important if you are flying at Scottsdale is to listen to all the instructions given by the tower, even if the instruction is not for you. It will help you anticipate the instruction that you will get. For example, if a plane is in base and is clear to land and you are on downwind, then you may have to follow the traffic. Now let's take a look at some instructions that are more atypical. The first one could be in the previous list, but I decided to put it in this list because I didn't get this instruction until I got my private pilot license. Let's listen to it.
If you're 20, turn base and turn direct to the numbers.
In this case, the tower asks you to fly directly to the runway. You won't fly a base and you won't fly a final.
Aviator 42, make another left 360. I need you to rejoin to beam the tower, please.
This is the right or left 360, but you will have to rejoin I beam the tower, which means that your 360 is more like an oval and not a circle.
Minute with Yankee, make an S turn to the right. Your number 2 flying a Cessna turning a half mile final, make a little S turn to your right.
I never received this instruction. Generally, it's to slow down the plane on final because there is a plane landing before them.
4-2, start climb, go around.
I got this instruction twice. One time because the plane couldn't take off, and the second time because the jet was behind us and was coming too fast.
Aviator 5-2, are you able to make a short approach?
In general, the pilot will ask for a short approach, but it may happen that the tower asks you to do a short approach if you can. What is a short approach? A short approach is when you turn base sooner than usual. Generally, your final should be less than half a mile. Now let's take a look at other situation. For most of the airport, you tell your direction of flight or intention to ground. At Scottsdale, you need to give this information to the tower. For example, you will call the ground and tell them, Scottsdale ground, Skyhawk 12345 at kilo ramp, request taxi for departure. And you will call tower and tell them, Scottsdale tower, Skyhawk 12345 holding short runway 21 alpha 16, request north departure. As I mentioned before, you may find yourself waiting on the taxi lane, ready to take off. In this case, your location is in sequence. When you inform tower, you are ready to take off. To give you an example, it will be something like this. Scottsdale Tower, Skyhawk 12345, in sequence, request north departure. If you are a piston aircraft and requesting your IFR clearance, the squat code will be given by the tower before departure, not by clearance. And you will have to remind tower that you are on an IFR flight plan.
Gate hold procedures are in effect.
This is the reason why I think Scottsdale is one of the busiest airports. Gate procedure is mentioned in ATIS and means you need to call ground before you can start your engine. It's done because too many airplanes are departing or blocking the taxi lane. This most likely happened during the PGA Tour, Paris Jackson auction, and Thanksgiving weekend. Now I'm going to show you where you can find the noise abatement procedure and other information about Scottsdale Airport. You just need to go to Scottsdale Airport website, scroll down, and look for pilot guide and noise abatement procedure. Let me show you. We are on Scottsdale Airport website, scroll down, and you can find pilot guide and noise abatement. This is a PDF. If you click on it, you will get this PDF file with some valuable information. And if you scroll down, you will see the noise abatement procedure. Now let's take a look at some reporting point around Scottsdale Airport. The first one is Paradise Valley Mall if you're coming from the southwest. Let's take a look on the map. You can find Paradise Valley Mall here. Let's take a look at the picture. And here you can see the mall over here. Let's go to the next reporting point. Pinnacle Peak if you're coming from the north. And we can see it here on the map. Let's take a look at a picture. And you can see Pinnacle Peak over here. Next, we have the power plant. Let's take a look at the map. And you can see we cannot find the power plant on the map. But I will show you where you can find it. It's around here. Let's see a picture of it. You can see Scottsdale Road and the power plant here. And that's most of the reporting point that you will use if you are flying to Scottsdale. Now let's find out how to get to the airport and fly the pattern. If you are coming from the north, most likely the tower will ask you to report at the power plant. It's important to know where it is. I use the power plant for three reasons. Number one is because you just need to follow the power lane and you will find the power plant. Number two, the power plant is 5 miles from the airport, which is a good distance for you to start being at pattern altitude. And number three, it's very easy to enter the pattern if you are at the power plant. Let me show you. You can see the power plant is right here, next to Scottsdale Road. You just need to follow Scottsdale Road after you reach the power plant here. And if you go on runway 21, you can just turn and enter. Or you will do a stay closer to Scottsdale Road and enter here for runway 3. Now let's take a look at another case. Let's say if you are at Deer Valley Airport, you can follow the highway or the power line. Let's take a look on the map. If you are south of the airport, you can follow the highway here. If you are north of the airport, you can follow the power line here that will bring you to the power plant. Now for our third case scenario. If you're coming from the east, you can follow the canal and then Shea Boulevard. You can see the canal here if you are southeast, or you can directly come from Shea Boulevard here. Once you are at Shea Boulevard, then you can stay north of Shea Boulevard to enter in the pattern. Now let's go over our last case. From the west, you look for Pistoia Peak and Paradise Valley Mall. Pistoia Peak here and Paradise Valley Mall here. You will fly between the mountain, pass over Paradise Valley Mall, and just enter the pattern here. Now we know how to get to the airport. It's time to see what we know about the pattern and is there any ground reference point we can use. You will mostly fly the pattern on the west side. First, runway 21 is the right traffic and runway 3 is the left traffic. As you can see, you will be on the west side of the airport. The tower will try to keep traffic on the west side because of the residential area on the east side. Now, our first reference point is the needle. It's at the cross street of Scottsdale and Franklin Drive, right here. Let's take a look at a picture. You can see the needle right here. Very easy to see from an airplane. Next, you can see that the needle is approximately 1.1 mile from the runway. This helps you keep your downwind close to the airport. As a private pilot, I used to fly over the needle, but as I started my commercial training, I got closer to the runway. It makes your power off 180 easier, and you end up doing more touch and go if you keep your pattern closer. Our next reference point is westward, and it can be used in many situations. You can see westward right here. Let's take a look at the picture. This picture was taken from the west, and you can see the dome of westward right here. Next, this picture was taken from the south, and again, you can see the dome. Let's see how we can use westward as a reference point. In the first situation, you're flying downwind for runway 21. And when you turn base, you can see that westward should be right in front of you. This is the first case scenario. In the second case scenario, if the tower asks you to directly enter in base, then you can use westward as a reference point to enter directly in base. In our third case scenario, if you are on the east side of the runway, then westward will be used for your downwind as a reference point for your downwind, as you saw in the picture. And this is it for our second reference point. Let's talk about the landing scenario which happened at Scottsdale. This is not specific to Scottsdale, but I want to talk about it because I did not know the regulation in this case. And I think a lot of pilots are in the same situation as I was. You are on final for runway 21, and the tower clears you to land. You reach the runway threshold, and you can see there is an airplane on the runway at Alpha 4. What do you do? Did the tower make a mistake? Most pilots will do a go-around and think the tower made a mistake. But it would be the wrong assumption. Let's read an article from Bold Method. Same runway separation to arrival. According to the FAA Air Traffic Control Procedure Manual, an aircraft can land on a runway when the other aircraft has landed and is clear of the runway. This is what we are all aware of. But if it's between sunrise and sunset, this requirement does not apply if minimum distance from the landing threshold exists. 3,000 feet of separation when a Category 1 aircraft is landing behind a Category 1 or 2 aircraft, which means that you can land. Now remember, you are the PIC. You may be allowed to land, but if you don't feel comfortable, just do a go around. Let's take a look about basic information, which we overlook sometimes when we fly to an airport. Here is the first one. Runway 3 is a calm wind runway. You will use it at night and in the morning. If there is wind at Scottsdale, it will most likely favor runway 21. Next. Runway 3 has a major displace threshold of 740 feet. Here is a picture. You can see the threshold here, and you can see that I'm below glide slope. Officially, I was aiming for the number. Next, no midfield departure, which means no stop and go at night. It's taxi back. Touch and go are prohibited between 9:30 p.m. and 6 a.m. And remember, the glide slope is 4 degrees at Scottsdale, which means that your descent rate must be greater than other airports. Thank you for watching Fly Easy Not Crazy. I hope this video helped you, and remember to subscribe for more videos. Thank you.